Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. As explained already, Madeleine, we will start this afternoon of technical presentation with the physical layer. And I will speak about two things which has been integrated in ATS-C3, multiple physical layer pipe, and the possibility to operate single frequency network. And I will explain why it is interesting for broadcasters to use this technology. As you must remember, our work in the physical layer is to modulate what? We use big transmitter, and we print on the what we modulate the information to broadcast. This information propagates on air and reach a rooftop antenna, and finally, the watt just attenuate when they travel from the transmitting antenna to the receiving antenna. When you reach from the rooftop antenna the TV set, which is located here in the background of this house, it happens that if it remains, the modulated watt just encounter the noise floor of the tuner. And then if this building is located very far away from the transmitting antenna, the level of watt modulated is not sufficient, you know, to overpass the noise floor. So the C over N is very small. The ratio between C over N is very small. And in the analog time, of the analog TV time, what happens generally is that you have snow on the picture, you know, simply because the noise floor of the tuner is above the watt you receive, the modulated watt you receive. So it's impossible to reproduce the color of the pixel because in fact it is the noise who win in this battle between carrier, modulated watt, and noise. For sure, if you have not the help of a rooftop antenna, it is more difficult to acquire the signal on a TV set like the one you have on the first floor just using an indoor antenna, because the watt which reach the house just attenuate further due to the building penetration loss. So possibly you can watch the TV signal with the rooftop antenna but not with the indoor antenna. And it becomes more and more complicated for the broadcaster when you reach the deep indoor receiver, that's the one with a purple antenna, because the attenuation is very, very strong. So what happens in a given location, depending of the receiver location and depending of the receiver situation, with the help of a rooftop antenna, with the help of an external antenna, without the help of an embedded antenna, which is a third category of indoor receiver, possibly you will not have the same reception capability or the same coverage. You will not reach the same coverage. It was the time of the analog TV I am speaking on. Another thing we discover with analog TV is what we call the ghost picture. Because the transmitting antenna is radiating omnidirectionally, it happens that some waves, the wave, just propagate from the transmitting to the receiving antenna in direct line of sight. But because the transmitting antenna is using omnidirectional pattern, then the same wave just propagate, reflect on the wall, and reach your receiving antenna. It's the same information, but which arrive with some delay. You know that wave propagate is the speed of light. So every time a wave travel 300 meters more than the direct line of sight, you have 1 microsecond. 300 meters of differential path means 1 microsecond. And if you remember well, on the analog TV time, the duration of a line, of a TV line, is around 64 microseconds, 56 in your country. But it's around 50 microseconds. 1 microsecond, which means 300 meter, means that the same line is received twice at the initial time, and 300 meter, 1 microsecond delay. 600 meter, 2 microsecond delay. And what happens on the TV set? On the TV set, you see a ghost picture. Two pictures, just one slightly delayed from the first. That's the multipath propagation. The famous echo of the signal, simply because the same information travel more or less with different paths. It was a good time of the analog TV. Unfortunately, we invent the digital TV. And the digital TV instead to modulate an analog signal with a megawatt, the megawatt with an analog signal, we modulate the megawatt with one or zero. So for each individual bit we use to modulate, when you reach the C over N, you know, the N, the noise floor, the bit is good or bad. You know? So you have not this graceful gradation we have in analog TV. If you move away from the transmitting antenna, the quality of service degrade gracefully. With the digital TV, you know, it's work. It doesn't work. You know, and it's part of a dB which makes a difference. It's why we have invented the protection of the data bit. Instead of transmit only bit, with any relation between each bit, we correlate the bit we transmit with a forward error code, which allow to recover some bit which has been inverted by the level of noise they have using. And then come ATSC3. For the first generation of broadcast system, we just consider one use case. The use case of receiving using a rooftop antenna. And it was the best effort, we consider that it is the best effort for indoor reception. Well, you say, my transmitter has a coverage of such number of kilometers, you know, or miles, you know, and within this area, we are able to provide service to all rooftop antenna. We eliminate with our big tower. Indoor reception, it's best effort. Deep indoor reception is best effort. And mobile reception, we say, possibly, we will have mobile reception. Unfortunately for us, the technician, the broadcaster want to serve with a unique radio frequency channel, with a unique transmitter tower. They want to serve simultaneously all these categories of receiver, either stationary or mobile. And we will see how we provide ATSC3 physical layer toolbox with the tools in order to optimize the use case represented by these various receiver situation. The first innovation was the physical layer pipe. In the radio frequency channel, channel 21, 39, and so on, with the first generation, we use a single protection, a single FEC, you know, in order to ensure to all bits inside the radio frequency channel the same level of protection. With ATSC3, we invented what we call the physical layer pipe, which means that we subdivide the radio frequency channel in few pipes, each pipe having its own level of robustness. And as you know, we transmit bits. We have capacity to transmit a certain number of bits. Then the trade-off you have to choose is the number of video and audio bits you want to transmit versus the number of protection bit, that means the FEC, the forward error correction. Nothing is for free. Eh? So if you want to have a robust signal, you need to increase the number of forward error correction bit at the expense of the audio and video, and vice versa. It's why we call it a trade-off between bit rate and robustness. The scheme was unique in first generation system. With the second generation system, you are able to subdivide your bitrate capacity in several pipes, and for each pipe, you decide the trade-off between protection bit, robustness, and bitrate, audio and video. That's a major advantage. And the full definition of the physical layer pipe is you implement in individual pipe a given BICM configuration, that means you choose the constellation, QPSK, 16 QAM, 64 QAM. For each of these constellations, the carriage capacity is different. QPSK, you have 2 bits per carrier. 16 QAM, you have 4 bits per carrier. 256 QAM, you have 8 bits per carrier. And you decide the level of FEC and the interleaving. That's the definition of the physical layer pipe. But in addition with ATSC3, which is not the case in other systems like the DVB-T2, you assign the PLP on a given Y-form configuration. That's the additional degree of liberty you have. It's to define the subcarrier, the subframe configuration for which will carry the PLP, the physical layer pipe. I will explain why it's important to have these 2 degrees of liberty when you consider mobile versus stationary reception, and when inside this, each of these use case, mobile, stationary, you consider indoor reception or outdoor reception with the help of an external antenna or not. And for sure, for the second generation of broadcast system, you have to consider the whole organization of your transmission infrastructure. So we have to generate IP multi-stream, multicast stream in the studio, possibly for several services simultaneously. You have to transport them to the TV station, and then you have to transmit them, possibly using several transmitters acting as a single frequency network, such to improve the C, the watt, the level of watt you provide over a given area. So the mystery of the physical layer, of the ATSC3 physical layer. As you know, we use what we call a modulation scheme named COFDM, coded orthogonal frequency division multiplex. Coded means that we use FEC to protect the bit of information. And OFDM is the way we structure the waveform. I try to represent here the radio frequency channel. On the horizontal axis, it is the time axis. On the vertical axis, it's a frequency. So you have one portion, one segment of the radio frequency channel during a segment of time. And we start by using what we call the bootstrap. It's a way for the receiver to lock on what we call the frame, that means this segment of time. And in this bootstrap, we indicate, guys, the frame is built using the ATSC 3.0 standard. But we can say also in this bootstrap, this frame is using the ATSC 3.5 standard in 5 years' time. That means, naturally, with this time division multiplex approach, you have the way to simulcast various versions of the standard, you know, in the same radio frequency channel, then to serve simultaneously various population of receivers responding to various levels. You know, for instance, if we have that with ATSC1, you can have a segment of time using ATSC1 modulation and another segment of time using ATSC3 modulation. Because by concept, the receiver just ignore a frame he is not able to demodulate because he don't know what carries this frame. But he, without losing the synchronization, is waiting for the next occurrence of the bootstrap characterizing its what he is able to demodulate. Following the bootstrap, we have what we call the preamble that is defined in A322 standard, and it is simply the table of content. We just say in this frame you will find one program using 4K, one program using high definition, audio, video, and so on. You define the PLP, in fact, and the subframe characteristic you will use for the transmission. And then let's go to what is COFDM, OFDM, Orthogonal Frequency Division Multiplex. OFDM has been invented here in US. In the 60s, the Bell Laboratory engineer have to respond to the question, how is it possible to have a maximum of subcarrier within a radio frequency channel without interfering, each subcarrier interfering with each other, without using any guard band, any blank between subcarrier, because we will lose transmission capacity. And the guy says, very simple, you have to set up the distance between subcarrier, that is, voilà, the distance between subcarrier, that is the upper, to be the reverse of the duration of the modulated. So if you use the subcarrier during one millisecond, you have to provide 1 kilohertz between each subcarrier. So in this example, we have 8,000 subcarriers in a 6 megahertz channel. So it means that subcarrier spacing is 800 hertz. And then the duration of each subcarrier, the duration during which you transmit the modulated beat, you modulate the subcarrier, is the reverse. 1/8 means 1200 microseconds, roughly 1 millisecond, you know? And then you can also define, and ATSC allow to do that, to define another way. Instead to using 8,000 subcarrier, we use 16,000. And then in a 6 megahertz channel, the subcarrier distance is divided by 2. And as a consequence, the duration, the symbol period, is multiplied by 2. So 800 hertz versus 400 hertz, 1200 microseconds versus 2400 microseconds. You can say. What is interesting here is that the transmission capacity of the signal is totally independent of the number of subcarriers. Because in 16K, you have twice the number of subcarriers, but the duration of the modulation is twice. Okay, so you don't win any transport capacity. So you can say to me, but why don't we continue to use 32K FFT? 32K FFT with 200 hertz subcarrier spacing and then 4 milliseconds duration. Except the noise floor, you know, or the noise of the receiver, you can increase the number of subcarriers using this rule. The distance between subcarriers shall be the reverse of the symbol duration. But then, as we are broadcasters, we know the ghost picture. We know the echo, 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 echo. What happens when you have an echo? You receive the same signal, delayed in time. And you can see at the border of the two symbols that the first symbol just pollutes the beginning of the following symbol. You know, because inside the symbol, you have no rupture of phase. The phase is regular, you know, except as the boundary between two symbols. When you have the echoes, 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 you see that the end of the first symbol pollutes the beginning of the other symbol. It's pure noise. That means the receiver who is performing an 8K FFT sample 8K sample from the antenna and perform the FFT, but unfortunately the beginning, the symbol he got at the beginning of the sample he got at the beginning of the symbol are false. They are noise. So he cannot recover the beat which have been transmitted during on such subcarrier. So the basic idea of the COFDM is to add what we call the guard interval, the cyclic prefix. What it is mean? It means that we extend at the expense of the transmission capacity, we extend the duration of the subcarrier without creating any phase disruption. You can see that we extend from a given period. In this case, the cyclic prefix period is 148 microseconds, which is a pure loss of transmission capacity. But using that, we just explain to the receiver, don't sample your antenna during the guard interval period. Because it is a meshing area where the echo of the previous symbol pollutes your given the current receiving symbol. And then we this 8K FFT receiver will sample 8K sample on its antenna, even if we transmit 8,000 plus 200 or 300 sample, which doesn't carry any more, any new information. So that's a pure loss. And then you understand why we have 8K FFT and 16K FFT. 8K FFT, 148 microseconds of cyclic prefix, means that we have an overhead of 12%. If we use twice 16K FFT, 16K FFT, the guard interval overhead is only 6%. And if we were use 32K FFT, this one, the duration of the symbol is twice, that means 4 milliseconds, and then the guard interval overhead will be reduced to 3%. So the broadcasters say, if we want to be robust against echo and maximize the transmission capacity, we have to move directly to 30K FFT. Like that, the absolute value of the guard interval will represent only 3% of loss in transmission capacity. That's true, except if you consider mobile reception. Because if you consider mobile reception, there is another impairment. And the other impairment is a Doppler. You know the Doppler? When you watch a car race, a Formula One car race, you know, and you have a car coming from there and going there, what do you hear? You hear something like vroom. When the car goes to you, frequency increase. When the car goes back to you, the frequency of the noise decrease. That means the echoes which are received in motion are received with a shift in frequency. And the shift in frequency is represented on the subcarrier drawing. You see that the shift in frequency just destroys the orthogonality. The subcarrier of the echoes, the energy carried in each subcarrier of the echoes, pollute the main signal and destroys the, and if you pollute the main signal, you are not any more able to extract the bit modulated at the origin. It's why in ITSC3 we decided to have a subframe. That means the first part of the frame is using 8K FFT, and the second part of the frame is using 32K FFT, 16K FFT. And when we have this vehicle, the OFDM vehicle ready, we are able to map on this the pipe, the physical layer pipe. And in this example, we use PLP1, PLP2, 3 and 4, and we organize the physical layer pipe as a TDM inside each subframe. It's possible with ATSC3 to organize as a frequency division multiplex, or as it will be presented by our colleague of A3, as an LDM, layered division multiplex. I don't speak about that because A3 will have an excellent presentation on this. So in summary, that is the COFDM we use in ATSC3. Bootstrap, table of content, PLP map on subframe, each subframe optimized for mobile reception, that is the case for 8K, or stationary reception, that is the case for 16K. I design a calculator able to play with all parameters and allowing to you to play with all parameters to understand what you have to pay, how much bitrate you lose when you have this setting, how much robustness you win, and so on and so on. So in this example, I show four subframes, two of them being optimized for mobile and two of them for stationary. I reduce the guard interval to 56 microseconds, which means roughly 10 miles. 10 miles of, yeah. And for mobile, you have the capacity to receive at 108 mile per hour, while for the stationary, it's limited to the speed, maximum speed, the maximum Doppler is limited to 45 mile per hour. Doing all this setting, I try to minimize overhead. That means I have a waveform efficiency of 95% and an overhead of only 5%. then you are able to map on this your PLP. So I have four subframes with four pilot patterns, and I decided to have a first PLP. I have four PLP for a capacity of roughly 26 megabit per second. Then your boss is coming. Your boss says, guys, I have a transmitter. I represent an Eiffel Tower. I am French, I am sorry. An Eiffel Tower. And I have a transmitter with an antenna at 300 meter. I have a 15 kilowatt transmitter. Could you explain to me what will be the coverage? And I say, due to the setting you have done, you are able to serve a mobile receiver at up to 30 miles, in-car receiver at 20 miles, indoor reception, stationary indoor reception at 15 miles, and outdoor receiver at 17 kilometers, 11 miles. That's a way to present the thing. You can also present the thing and saying, every category of receiver located at less than 11 miles will receive the four services. At 25 kilometers, only you will receive only three services, then two services, then the portable at 40 kilometers will receive only one services. You know, due to the physics, the wave propagate and attenuate. And unfortunately, your boss has a house located at 60 kilometers. And they say, you are not able to serve me. That's rubbish. You have to review completely your planning. I want to receive my content. And then you say, oh, but you know, because we are able with COFDM to fight against echo. That's just a matter of guard interval. If I use a second transmitter, being the exact echo of each other, each sample radiated by the two transmitting antenna are exactly the same at each instant. A perfect co-channel interferer. If it is synchronized in time, in frequency, in data content, then the receiver located in the middle will just think that it receives multiple echoes. Passive echoes coming from reflection or active echo provided by another transmitter exactly synchronized with the first one. Single frequency network operation. Two transmitters using the same radio frequency channel and contributing to increase the C over the covered area. And then if you do that, you can see that the first transmitter provides the blue coverage, the second transmitter the green coverage, and if they are exactly synchronized, the watt of heat coming from each transmitting antenna will sum up to provide the orange coverage curve. And then everyone is covered. Magic, super. But one guy who understands the guard interval come to you and say, hey, with the guard interval you have chosen to minimize overhead, when the blue wave has propagated 17 kilometers, it becomes an interferer for the green wave. Due to the distance it propagates, the delay, you know, of propagation, and vice versa. When the green wave has propagated 17 kilometers, it becomes an active interferer for the blue wave. So no, you don't sum up, you interfere. You know, you make interference. The unique solution is to change the value of the guard interval. So you have to play again with the tools I provide. You increase the guard interval at the expense of the bitrate. And you can see that the guard interval is above the distance, is quasi equal to the distance between two transmitters. And then you can say that every watt coming from each part will just sum up in order to guarantee that every category of receiver will be covered. You know, but for sure it's not for free, because you have increased the guard interval value, you decrease, you increase the overhead, and then you decrease the bitrate capacity. That's a trade-off between coverage and capacity. That's it's exactly what I say. It's not for free. You reduce from 26 megabit to 24, so you lose roughly 2 megabits, but you extend the coverage for everyone from 17 kilometers to 67 kilometers. So even if for free, the SFN is magic. And I will just 2 minutes. So in conclusion, because my boss, in conclusion, that's the Shannon limit. Mr. Shannon was also an American who invented the theory of information, and he demonstrates that it's impossible for a given level of noise to transmit more than such amount of bit per second per hertz. You have so that is the Shannon limit, which is the ultimate boundary of what we are able to provide on air. All the red points are ATSC3. The purple points are LTE, the LTE, the 4G, and you can see that ATSC3 is more close to the Shannon limit. That means it's more efficient, more spectrum efficient than 4G, you know? Then you see in the C over N, the range where you can, where mobile reception work, non-line of sight, portable, you know, between 6 and 15 dB, and stationary reception above 15 dB C over N. That's what happens generally on the field. And generally, when you have to set up your transmission, you decided to have a good bit rate, you know, between 4 and 5 bit per second per hertz. You set up PLP in the range located in the blue area in order to provide on air a signal with a threshold of 15 to 18 dB. If you consider portable reception, you have to consider an additional attenuation of the C. Then you set up red point in the yellow area to provide on air a signal between 9 and 12 dB C over N. If you consider mobile, as I said, you have to consider an additional noise coming from the Doppler. The echoes are not delayed in time only, delayed on time and shifted in frequency. Then you have to consider additional noise, 6 to 9 dB, in order to carry to provide a service to a mobile outdoor receiver. And then you target point, transmission point, acting, providing 3 to 6 dB C over N. And finally, when you consider mobile indoor reception, that means embedded antenna, indoor like embedded antenna, you have to provide the signal receivable around 0 dB C over N. And that shows you 2 PLP for stationary, 2 PLP for mobile, the PLP for mobile carried by the 8K FFT subframe, and the stationary provided onto a 32K or 16K FFT. And my final conclusion, and I hope you will share this with me, I love ATSC3.